Come on, put your hands above your head tonight.
Seat to there it is, we're back. Yes, wonderful, thank you. Welcome to First Baptist Church. Thank you for joining us this morning. I am incredibly excited right now. Guess why? Because we're all together. I love this stuff. I know we're kind of crammed in, and maybe you got stuck next to someone you've never been that close to before in your life. That's okay. This is church. We're here to do this together. We're excited about the possibilities of this morning. Just a couple announcements. First of all, want to thank all that were involved with celebrating Millie Alfred's life yesterday. We lost Millie last Sunday, and it just seems unbelievable. But we had a great time yesterday of celebrating and remembering her and thinking about how her life really pointed to the gospel. So I'm so thankful for the opportunity to do that. We're also celebrating this week, Wednesday night, on his way home with one of our youth staff, Matthew Smith. Stand up, Matthew. Okay, Matthew Smith accepted Christ as his Savior, and we are super pumped. And one of the things you will see with new believers is they are excited to tell people about that. And Matthew called yesterday morning and asked if we could put it in the bulletin. And I said, well, it's already printed, but we're going to announce it Sunday morning. So we are thankful for the gospel, and we're thankful for Matthew and his trusting in that. And be praying for him and for the rest of our youth and youth staff as they continue to disciple each other. Couple quick announcements. Lincoln Community Center desserts. If you've signed up out here or if you'd like to sign up, there's still time. But you need to bring those desserts before noon on Wednesday. So that is the cutoff time where we have to pack them up and drive them down to Lincoln Center. So if you're signed up for that, please do. Please make sure that those are in on Wednesday. And also, we have an opportunity tomorrow. There's a couple time slots tomorrow, and there's some time slots on Thursday to kind of group effort this thing and decorate for Christmas. Now, I know it's a busy week, and some of you have family in town, and they didn't expect this, but you bring them with you, and, you know, just they're captive in your house. They have no other option, right? So bring, and if we could get here tomorrow and decorate, that will help Heidi out and certainly be able to decorate for Christmas so that when we come back next week, we are, well, the place looks different. It's kind of exciting. So if you can do that, sign up or let Heidi know that you can do that today because that's going to get started tomorrow. So we have that going on. And one more announcement. Yes, we announced this last week. Maybe not everybody realized because it happened last Sunday morning. But Natalie Grace Winteregg was born last Sunday, and we have a rose here for you. Here she is, 6 pounds 9 ounces, and is very cute, obviously. So we're celebrating with the Wintereggs some more. This is what we call organic church growth, right? So that's what that is. But we are thankful for this morning, and looking forward to serving together this morning. We have a Thanksgiving video that we're going to share now this morning as we begin to prepare our hearts for worship this morning.
I want Thanksgiving to be different. I don't want the holiday that takes heaps of planning and multiple trips to the grocery store, only for it to just come and go. This year, there's not a hug I'll receive, not a door I'll walk through, not a person I'll visit that will be taken for granted. I want Thanksgiving to be different. In times past, we'd say the obligatory Thanksgiving prayer, hold hands, bow heads, fight eager appetites. This year, I want to feel the hunger, the eagerness to thank God for what we once hardly noticed, a quiet gratitude in our hearts for all the small things God's granted us. Whether the whole family is together, whether there's one seat or two left empty, if our table is full and abundant or feeling the sting of a hard year, whether we've seen deliverance through all things or received strength despite hard things, we will give thanks. When all is well or nothing looks right, if we've gathered with many or sit in quiet solitude, by the grace of God, we will raise our hands to the one who gives and takes away. So I come to the table on this special day and give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. That is how we make Thanksgiving different.
Amen. Please stand with me as we begin to worship this morning. I know there's uncertainty of this year and stresses and trials that we've all gone through, but we still have so much to be thankful for. Psalm chapter 100 says, "Make a joyful shout unto the Lord, all you lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who has made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful to him and bless his name, for the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting, and his truth endures to all generations.
be seated.
Hello, my name is Bob Sotzing, and I've been a member of this church, First Baptist Church here in Troy, since 1989. My wife became a member in October of 1989, and we got married by Pastor Peters in 1989, right here in this church, when we still had the little chapel. I want to read from you before I go any further into what I was going to say, from Dr. Jeremiah's devotional in November. It was the one from November 8th, so many of you may have read it. It says, "You do not know what will happen tomorrow," James 4:14. Talk about bad timing. On September 16, 2008, the Wall Street Journal's magazine, Smart Money, featured a cover showing two chickens hatching. The accompanying words said, "Double your nest egg. Now is the time to jump into cheap stocks." On that same day, the stock market began its worst drop since the Great Depression, sending the nation into a deep recession on September 29th of that year that took years to overcome. Someone said that timing is everything, yet we don't know what will happen later today, let alone tomorrow. But there is someone who knows. The psalmist said, "My times are in your hand," Psalm 31:15. The psalmist also said, "I will bless the Lord at all times," Psalm 34:1. And he said, "Trust in him at all times," Psalm 62:8. We don't know what tomorrow holds, and we don't have the wisdom to exercise perfect timing in all the events of life. But God is the great timekeeper. We can bless him and trust in him at all times. When you don't know what to do, wait on the Lord and watch for him to work. His timing is impeccable. During the past year and a half, I experienced a lot of these things. At one time, I was talking with Clara Lois Adams, and she once said, "If we knew what was going to happen in our lives, we'd be afraid to live." And probably if I'd known what was going to happen in my life, I would have been afraid to live. But through the help of this church, the fellowship, the love, the pouring out of taking care of our needs, we carried on and we made it through. My wife was diagnosed with Alzheimer's back last summer. And it continually got worse. She also had some issues with her vertebrae, fractures, and had a number of hospital stays. They were trying to make her better, but because she no longer had a memory that would retain certain things, physical therapy wouldn't work for her. In March, after many hospital stays, many emergency crew members from Troy coming out and helping us lift her up, all of which we're very thankful for, social workers at Kettering Hospital called us in and said that the prognosis was not good, that Joyce was going to continue to deteriorate. They were very truthful about it all. They said, "You'll see some good days and you'll think everything's wonderful. And there might be a good day and then several days when things are bad. And each time the bad will get worse," which is what happened. And this continued. They told us from 5 months to 5 years would be the timeline. Her death actually occurred 5 months, about after the time we were told this. During this time, First Baptist Outpouring was remarkable. I have no words to say other than thank you for all that you did. I can give you or attest to that one experience, but I can attest to many of them. But one day at about 8:30 in the morning, Mrs. Shaughnessy appeared at the door with bags of snacks for us and with a lap blanket, I guess that's what you call it, for Joyce. By 11 o'clock, the phone was ringing, and Jim Kinninger was calling to make arrangements about mowing the yard and taking care of the yard, which he did. My yard never looked better. He went out of his way. I also put a little addendum in here that midsummer, a storm came along and blew the window out of our barn, the second floor window, and I didn't know how I was going to get it fixed. Jim fixed it. He fixed it so nicely that you can't even tell that there was a window there. But later that same day, Andy Runyon appeared, and he built a ramp for us to get Joyce in and out. And Mr. Kininger came and helped him. And later on, I looked out, maybe a day or so later, and Ron Trossel was out there helping. And all of this was just unbelievable to me. There were phone calls, there were cards, there were meals provided. Dolores Bear, Sharon Saunders came by with some flowers and meals for Joyce, and all of which she appreciated. Hospice provided a care that was remarkable, and that was a music ministry. So they would send a music therapist out every week, or every couple of weeks rather, and we'd sing songs. So we asked her if the life group could join us on those Monday mornings, and they said sure. And that way I found out also exactly probably what Joyce would have had when sung at her funeral services. There were just so many things that I do not want you to think that I'm slighting anyone, but with my 72-year-old memory, I can't remember all the things that happened. It was one event after another. They say, pray without ceasing. That's in the Bible, Thessalonians. And sometimes I thought, I'm not getting the prayers and I should be, but then I realized that I've been praying without ceasing the whole time this was going on. I would like to end this by just saying that there's a commercial on television, an anti-smoking commercial, that talks about, it's put on or presented by Mrs. Leonard Nimoy about her husband who died of cancer a few years ago. And she ends it by saying, you think you have all the time in the world, but you really don't. And I find out how fast time can go and how things can slip away from us. I am truly grateful to First Baptist for all that they have done for me and all the members here and all the kindness that's been expressed and the scripture that's given to us to read and understand. Thank you.
Amen. We appreciate you. Let's stand again as we continue in worship. Psalm 105 says, oh, give thanks to the Lord. Call upon his name. Make known his deeds among the peoples. Sing to him. Sing songs to him. Talk of all his wondrous works. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those rejoice who seek the Lord. Seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his face forevermore. Let's sing together.
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, and trembles at his voice. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And oh, see how great, how great. God. The day
Father, what a privilege it is to stand in the presence of our great God. Thank you as we have sung together and worshiped your greatness, your power, your love, your majesty. What a blessing to come before you with thanksgiving and praise here this morning. Father, I thank you for Bob's testimony, how grateful he is in the time of sorrow and grief, yet he's so grateful to you. Father, may that be a testimony to all of us. We've gone through some difficult times in recent days as a church, as a ministry, as individuals, as a country, as a world. And yet, Father, you desire to, through all of this, to turn hearts to you. What a tremendous testimony of gratefulness because of who you are. And may that speak to our hearts, and may we be refreshed and encouraged and challenged, and you be glorified in all of these things, even this day. Thank you, and we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Boy, it's great to see everyone out this morning, and what an opportunity to gather together here to as we say, together for Christmas, but we're here starting Sunday before Thanksgiving, and I just rejoice in the fellowship that we share together here at FBC. Thank you for choosing to worship with us, and we're looking forward to a great week, and I love Thanksgiving. Thanksgiving is I've said before, that it's a holiday that the world can't take away from us. They try to, right? They try to call it Turkey Day, as if we're supposed to be thankful to the turkey, but we're thankful to God for his many blessings. We have so much for which to be thankful. We're looking forward to sitting down, many of us, to great food throughout this week. You know, you've all sat down to a meal, and maybe you've tasted something, or maybe you're preparing something, and you have a taste, and you think, something's missing, you know? And you think, oh, maybe it needs a little bit more sage, or maybe it needs a little more basil or Old Spice or something like that. You think, you know, something's missing. And it's one thing to be able to identify that something's missing, but it's another thing to say, this is just what it needs. And to come up with the solution for that. Have you ever felt that in life? Thought that, and you think, man, you know, and maybe you're here this morning, or maybe you're watching online, and you're just thinking, man, you know, I'm just going through life, and I'm looking, I'm searching, and things just aren't right. There's something missing. There's a missing ingredient. Maybe you can't quite put your finger on it. You can't quite identify it. My first question would be, could it be salvation? Maybe you're here, and maybe you're searching, and you're just wondering, man, you know, I'm looking for a purpose in life. And I'm here to tell you, if you've never trusted Christ as Savior, that is what is missing in your life. If you're not certain of salvation, you need Jesus. And we want to help you with that even here today. Because that's exactly what's missing. You don't have the right ingredients in order to live life. But most people here have trusted Christ, and there may be something that just is kind of off. You know, I'm just not sure what it is. You desire to grow, and you're putting forth some effort and trusting God to do that for you, and things just still seem to be a bit flat. What could it be? Well, I'm convinced that many believers would benefit from one essential spiritual ingredient or practice that would enhance their relationship with God immensely. And that is what we've been pointing to and looking to throughout this morning, and that is praise and thanksgiving. In fact, our take-home thought here this morning is praise and thanksgiving is essential to your relationship with God. If you've trusted the Lord Jesus as Savior, you need to be praising God and thanking Him. It's an essential ingredient to a vibrant relationship with God. And Psalm 98 is going to help us this morning to seek to grow in the areas of praise and thanksgiving. So I'd like you to read it with me. If you'd like to, and I know you're probably all ready to take notes and everything, but I'd like for you to stand. Would you mind standing together if you're able to stand? And we're going to project this, and I'd like for us to read this together. Read it in such a way that you can be heard. Don't just mumble under your breath, all right? Read it in such a way so as to be heard. Read it from your heart. Let's read it together out loud. Oh, sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. His right hand and his holy arm have worked salvation for him. The Lord has made known his salvation. He has revealed his righteousness in the sight of the nations. He has remembered his steadfast love and faithfulness to the house of Israel. All the ends of the earth have seen the salvation of our God. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Break forth with joyous song and sing praises. Sing praises to the Lord with the lyre and the sound of melody. With trumpets and the sound of the horn, Make a joyful noise before the King, the Lord. Let the sea roar and all that fills it, the world and those who dwell in it. Let the rivers clap their hands. Let the hills sing for joy together. Before the Lord, for the Lord to He will judge the world with righteousness and the peoples with equity. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. Wow, what a blessing to hear all of us join together as we recite that hymn, that song, that psalm this morning. And through this psalm, I'd like to encourage you with three characteristics of praise and thanksgiving this morning. And this first characteristic is sing a song of praise and thanksgiving. Look at verse 1. Sing a song of praise and thanksgiving. Sing to the Lord a new song. Now, don't misunderstand as we go. Praise and thanksgiving is not all wrapped up in just singing, all right? There are other ways in which we can praise the Lord. And nor is it a mere emotional response to the Lord. In fact, in other words, there are some people who just say, well, I just can't praise God. I can't praise God if I don't feel good. I can only praise Him when I feel good. Or I can't praise because I don't feel good. Or I'll praise God so that I will feel better. Now, I do think that if you praise God, that in time and over time, it will lift your spirits. But the reason for which we praise God is to obey His command to do so. By the way, praise is not just something we do at church, right? We ought to carry it with us throughout our day, throughout our weeks, throughout the months, days ahead. A couple features of praise is the song is a new song. It's a new song. It's a song of salvation. It's a result of realizing what God has done for you in salvation. That's why I say, if you're here and you're searching for something in life and you've never trusted Christ as Savior, that's what you need. Right, Matthew? That's right. You know, it's like, wow, life has a whole new lease on life because of salvation. They're just not the meaning in life without the salvation that our great God provides. And have the opportunity to sing a new song. All other things are secondary. You got to get that right. And you cannot properly praise God without salvation. First and foremost, because it honors God. Your salvation and then the praise by which you bring to Him, it honors Him. And we give Him His due. He is worthy of all our praise. And so you think about His attributes. How do you praise God? Well, we just sang just a moment ago, how great is our God. Sing with me. He's a great God. He's a loving God. For God so loved the world, He gave His one and only Son, that whosoever would believe in Him would not perish but have everlasting life. He's a loving God. He's a merciful God. He's a God who judges, but we remember that in light of His grace and His mercy. He's a gracious God. He's a faithful God. He's omnipotent. He's all-powerful. He's omnipresent. He's everywhere present. He's omniscient. He knows all things. We have a great and powerful God. And one way to praise Him is just to rehearse in your heart and your mind and to Him His attributes and thanking Him for all that He is and as well as all that He's done. And that produces great joy because it results from our obedience to Him. Sing to the Lord a new song. And another feature here is it's a song. The song is joyful. Look at verse 4. Shout for joy. I love that. Some of you literally upped the volume when we read that, right? Shout to joy to the Lord, all the earth. Burst into jubilant song with music. You know, having a song in your heart is indicative of joy. You know, one of the easiest ways to tell someone is in a good mood is when they're singing or whistling, right? I knew I could ask Dad for the car keys when I heard him whistling. you know. He just, you know, it's like, yeah, Dad's in a good mood. Hey, Dad, you know, and he's a good whistler, I'll tell you. And that's just an indication of what God is doing in your heart. It's hard to sing praises when you're down in the dumps. But have a song in your heart is indicative of joy. Having a song in your heart is also, now this might be a point of instruction for you, it's also an indication of the filling of the Spirit. In Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 18, it says, don't get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit. All right? In other words, in the same way that alcohol controls people, you know, you've witnessed that in some people. You know, it just overtakes them, and they can't function, and because they're being controlled by the alcohol. Don't get drunk on wine by alcohol, because it leads to things that aren't pretty, debauchery, sinfulness. But rather be filled with the Spirit. Instead of being controlled by that kind of substance, be filled, be controlled by the Holy Spirit of God. And that's allowing the Holy Spirit to work in you and through you in all areas of your life. It's not a matter of fullness. It's a matter of control, allowing Him to control you. Now, how do you know when that happens? Well, one indication is in verse 19. He says, speak to one another. Isn't that interesting? Speak to one another in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. Sing and make music in your heart to the Lord. It's one reason why I chose to have you stand and read that psalm together. Because he says, speak to one another. Wasn't it awesome to hear everybody join together and speak that psalm so that we could all hear it, but we speak it as unto the Lord. And as we look at this, that text, we realize that we tend to be more stable when we have a godly song on our hearts. Now, you need to realize, this is not something by which we judge other people. Oh man, he doesn't have much of a song in his heart. You know, no, it's a matter by which we judge our own hearts. You know, just saying, you know what? Maybe I need to go to the Psalms. I don't know about you, but I just so enjoy the worship that we have here at FBC, and these songs stick with me. I wake up humming them, singing them, whistling them so often through the week. And I hope you do too. Have that song in your heart. And when we do that, we tend to be more stable. We think about these truths. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. And when you do that, your focus is right. Instead of focusing on the fray around us, we focus on Him who's in control of all things, including that fray, right? But as we think about this, why then do we praise God? Well, that's where the second characteristic comes in. He says there, give praise and thanksgiving with purpose. You have an overwhelming motivation for praise and thanksgiving in these verses. They give us reason for praise. Verse 1 again, sing to the Lord a new song. Why? Because He has done marvelous things. This means difficult things, amazing things, miraculous things. All wrapped up in that word marvelous. He has done marvelous things. His right hand, His holy arm have worked salvation for Him. The Lord has made His salvation known and revealed His righteousness to the nations. He has remembered His love and His faithfulness to the house of Israel. Verse 1, again, He's done marvelous things. What has He done? Well, I think these verses give us some indications, four reasons to praise the Lord. Things He's done, mentioned here in the text. And there are many more, all right? This is just a taste. This is just to help you as you look ahead to how can I praise God in the days ahead. Well, the first thing is he's won the victory. Verse 1, his right hand and his holy arm have worked salvation for him. The idea here is that he has rescued you. He has provided that rescue. He's provided victory. He's won the victory in that Satan, the enemy, the devil, is a defeated foe. Praise God, right? I mean, we rejoice in that. He won the victory in that he was defeated through the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus. You know, the victory. Where, O death, is your sting? 1 Corinthians 15:57 says, but thanks be to God, he gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. In Revelation chapter 12, verses 10 and 11, it says, then I heard a loud voice in heaven say, now have come the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ. For the accuser of our brothers, that's the enemy, the accuser of our brothers, who accuses them before our God day and night, has been hurled down. They overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. He won the victory in that he has provided salvation for you, if you but believe. Interestingly, it was provided before you were born. In Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 4, he chose you in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless. Wow. You know, that kind of truth doesn't humble you to realize, again, how great is our God. I don't know what will. To give you cause for thanksgiving and praise. So he has won the victory, but we also see a second reason, and that is he made his salvation known. Verse 2, the Lord has made his salvation known and revealed his righteousness to the nations. Isn't that interesting? He has revealed his salvation to the unsaved. He wants all to know. By his grace and mercy, salvation is offered to all who will believe. You know, think of the blessing of being and the gratefulness that would be involved from being saved from impending doom. I haven't seen it. I'd like to see it because I've been to Thailand, but not during this event, but remember the boys that were stuck in that cave, and it flooded, and it took days to get to them. There's a documentary out on that. Have any of you seen that? Okay, I'd really like to see that. But could you imagine those boys in there, and there is no way out. We are stuck in this cave, and we have no idea if, when, or how we will ever get out. And the nation comes together, and the world comes together, and they get some expert divers to go in there. Could you imagine those boys when they start hearing, bloop, 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 and all of a sudden, you know, this guy comes up and says, hey, are you guys okay? And they're like, yeah, you know, could you imagine the thrill of seeing that? And then, okay, guys, we got a plan. We're going to try to get you out of here. And just one by one, being able to get those. Could you imagine the gratefulness of being saved from that impending doom? That's what happens when you get saved. Amen? I mean, Jesus saved you. That's something for which we ought to all rejoice and make a joyful noise to the Lord. Amen? Amen? Wow. He made his salvation known. It's not hidden. I just want to be suspect of groups and organizations that hide secrets to just a select few. It's like, that doesn't ring true. Why? Well, for one thing, God wants his salvation to be made known. He doesn't want it hidden. He makes it known to the nations. That's one reason why we support missionaries, to go into all the world. We support them. We pray for them, right? Because we want the world to know. That's why we're witnesses. That's why we want people to see Jesus in us. That's why when we have opportunities, we pray for opportunities to tell others about Jesus, right? Because God wants his salvation to be made known. And we praise him because of it. Aren't you glad he made his salvation known to you? Right? You know, just think about that. Thank you, God, for saving my soul. Another reason for praising the Lord is in verse 3. He has remembered his love and his faithfulness to the house of Israel. He keeps his promises. He keeps his promises. God remembered Israel. He freed them from Egyptian captivity. You know, they were down there in Egypt, and over a period of 400 years, they were put into captivity. And then he frees them from captivity. That you're talking about upwards to 2 million people freed from captivity, going through the Red Sea and wandering through the wilderness. And you know the events, that there was, because of their sin, they didn't go into the land. They had to wander for 40 years. But remember when they got into Jericho? And they go into Jericho some 40 years later. And what did they hear? The people of Jericho had heard that Israel was freed by their God all those years earlier. And it was such a monumental event that it was something for which they were to give God praise. God keeps his promises. He kept his promises to Israel. He keeps his promises to you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. He's not going to give you more than you can handle, so that you can bear up under the challenges that you have in life. You can resist the devil, and he will flee from you. He gives you joy and peace as you trust in him. Your salvation is secure. It is kept in heaven for you. Right? Those are promises. Promises for which you can praise God and thank him. And this gives us reason to praise. Another reason is for praising the Lord is he's coming again, right? Verse 9, he says, "Let them sing before the Lord, for he comes to judge the earth. He will judge the world in righteousness and the peoples with equity." This is a reference to him coming to judge upon his ultimate return. So we have so much for which to praise God. He's a just God. Yes, he's coming to judge, but he's just, he's merciful, he's loving, he's caring. We have so much for which to praise God. You praise him for who he is. He's almighty. He's the creator. Creator of the universe. He's sovereign. He's Lord. He's holy, just, pure, righteous, majestic. He's your Savior. You praise him for what he has entrusted to you, what he's provided for you, your life. Everybody, take a breath. Praise God for the air that you breathe. You know, we've all lost our breath at one point or another, right? It's just like, you know, and you gasp for that air. Praise God for the freedom by which you are able to breathe the air. Praise God for your health. Praise the Lord for your home, your job, your income, your family, your children, the beauty of nature, for your car, for your bed, for the curtains on the windows. You praise God for your food, the turkey, the mashed potatoes, the dressing, the green bean casserole, right? The pumpkin pie, the whipped cream. Praise God for your church family. Praise God for your teachers, for your pastors, for missionaries. And to put all of this in perspective, as you praise God for all of those things, and you can think of so much more, right? And I hope you do. It's just trying to prime the pump a little bit. But to put it in perspective, if it was not for the grace of God, you would have nothing. Nothing. You would not even have life itself. So much for which to praise God. Praise Him with purpose. Another characteristic of praise and thanksgiving. This one deals with how to praise God. And that's in verses 4 through 9. Give praise and thanksgiving from your heart. Praise and thanksgiving from your heart. Verse 4, shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Burst into jubilant song with music. Make music to the Lord with the harp. With the harp and the sound of singing, with trumpets and the blast of the ram's horn. Shout for joy before the Lord, the King. Let the sea resound and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. Let the rivers clap their hands. Let the mountains sing together for joy. Let them sing before the Lord, for He comes to judge the earth. He will judge the world in righteousness and the peoples with equity. So He gives us some direction here. You give praise and thanksgiving, first of all, with exuberance, with a joyful noise. Look at verse 4. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Burst into jubilant song. It literally means here, shout. You know, just think about how excited we get when our favorite team, Ohio State, you know, wins. I mean, you know, they score a touchdown. Yes, all right. Yeah, what a game yesterday. I mean, they won it in the first half, right? I mean, my goodness. And I don't know about you, but I get really excited. And if I can get that excited about a silly football game, I can certainly get excited about God. And that's one of the things that really led me to raise my hands and praise to God. Because if I can, yes, and I can praise my football team, I can certainly raise my hands and praise to God. You know, and it's biblical. The scriptures tell us to do that. And I, at first I was kind of like, you know, Bob, I appreciate you. I've watched you for years here at FBC. And you start singing, and usually it's during the invitation because that's when I can see you, you know. And I'd see Bob over there with his hands like this, you know. He's praising God. Thank you, Bob. But what we do with our hands is one way that in which we can praise the Lord. I'm not mandating it. I'm just saying, hey, give it a try sometime. You know, just praise God from whom all blessings flow. That's one reason. That has the idea of exuberance with a joyful noise. We also give praise and thanksgiving by singing. Verse 5, make music to the Lord with the harp and the sound of singing. We talked about that earlier. Psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. That means all kinds of singing, all kinds and all types of music. And music ought to express a joy and a happiness to the Lord, to worship Him with all types of music. I think that's one reason why the combined service is really good, because we can practice that together. And we can do this as we submit to one another in brotherly love. Because it's not about us, it's all about God, right? It's like, God, to whom be all glory and praise. And you have practiced that this morning, and you have done it very well. Thank you. So we give praise by singing. We give praise and thanksgiving with instruments. Verses 5 and 6, make music to the Lord with the harp and the sound of singing, with trumpets and the blast of the ram's horn, shout for joy. Now, this will be a startling to some of you. It means split the ear. Here. As with an alarm. You know, I'm going to mention in just a few moments We were down in Florida and had a hurricane, and you know, in the middle of the night, you heard me talk about this a few months ago, but it's just, you know, just, oh man, it just woke us up out of a dead sleep, right? And that's what it, shout for joy before the Lord, the King. This indicates all kinds of instruments. music to the Lord, harp, trumpets, ram's horn. It indicates the harp, the trumpets, ram's horn, signaling joy and victory. Now, it's not limited to these instruments. These are mentioned here. It mentions all other kinds of instruments in the scripture. There are other kinds. Now, not every instrument is mentioned in the Bible. You don't have a piano, you don't have an organ, a keyboard, you don't have an electric guitar. Those weren't invented yet. But the variety of instruments that are mentioned in the scripture indicates that there's no instrument that's forbidden. So there's a broad spectrum that's acceptable. So we give praise and thanksgiving with instruments. We give praise and thanksgiving along with the rest of creation. Join the band, right? Just join the band. The rest of the world, the rest of creation is praising God. Look at verse 7. Let the sea resound and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. Let the rivers clap their hands. Let the mountains sing together for joy. Let them sing before the Lord, for he comes to judge the earth. He will judge the world in righteousness, the peoples with equity. You see, creation reveals God. And it praises God as well. You know, I love watching the sea. When we were, down in Florida this summer, we were told there was a hurricane heading our way. And it was coming up the west coast there, and it was going to hit Tampa, and we were staying right there, St. Pete Beach and all of that, and it's hot, heading your way. And we weren't sure exactly, it wasn't going to be a strong storm, so we decided, let's see what's going to happen, let's wait. And it was so fascinating to me, because as I looked, sitting on the balcony of where we were staying, and you could just see the clouds just starting to come in, just rolling in. And then you know, it was kind of calm where we were, but you could see the white caps to the south of us just start to, and the white caps were getting closer and closer. It was indicating the wind is coming your way. You know, it was just fascinating. And the longer we got into it, it looked like it was going to stay offshore, which it did. But we still got wind. We still got effects from that storm. But I'm telling you, I'm fascinated by that kind of stuff. As I watch the power of those storms, it makes me think of the power of God. I'm fascinated by it. I got up, I don't know if any of you did, but I woke up at 4 in the morning the other day, Friday morning, and I thought, I'm going to look at the moon. You know, I'm going to look at the moon. Because it was going to be a 97% lunar eclipse, and it was going to look red. So I get up and I'm like, overcast. It's like, oh, great. I didn't get to see it, but I sure wanted to. Why? Because creation reveals the greatness of our God. I love it. I love mountains. I love sunrises. I love sunsets. I love mountains. I love gorges. I love forests. I love plains. I love sand dunes. You know, all of those things just fascinate me because it all points to the glory of God. Romans chapter 1, verse 18 says, the wrath of God is being revealed from all heaven against all the godlessness and wickedness of men who suppress the truth by their wickedness. Since what may be known about God is plain to them because God has made it plain to them, for since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that men are without excuse. When people in the world see creation, they realize there is someone greater than they. And you see cultures around the world worshiping something. It's like, that's why Paul said in Acts chapter 17 that they had an altar to an unknown God. Let me tell you who that God is. The great God of the Bible. So we give praise and thanksgiving to God with humility. Verse 9, with them sing before the Lord, for he comes to judge the earth. There is one greater than you, and that's Almighty God. He will judge the world in righteousness and the peoples with equity. He alone is righteous. He alone is the one who judges with equity. There's no favoritism with God. We've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, and we all need his salvation. And I trust you've come to him in that salvation today. If not, we want to help you with that. And as you come to him and have come to him, many of you, for salvation, you give praise and thanksgiving to God as an indication of a vibrant relationship with him. And by implication, that will enhance your relationship with God. In 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 18, it says, "But grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be glory both now and forever. Amen." An area in which many of us need to grow. And I confess that I don't praise God, and I'm not as thankful as I ought to be. But boy, I'm thankful for a holiday that says, you get it right. Right? You know, let's put our hearts into it, and let's remember our great God, to whom we must give praise and thanksgiving, not just on Thanksgiving Day or this week before Thanksgiving, but every moment of every day. Heavenly Father, help us, I pray. Help us to humble our hearts before you as we look to you and your greatness. You are our great God, to whom we give all praise and thanksgiving. We must decrease, you must increase. And I pray that if there's any here that do not know you, or anyone watching and listening that does not know you, they've come to you in salvation, and they would join with us then in praising our great God. So thank you. And again, Father, that we would go from here with exuberant hearts, rejoicing in your many blessings. So with heads bowed and eyes closed, we just encourage everyone to contemplate their hearts before God. We've asked the question, is something missing? And praise and thanksgiving is an essential ingredient that grows out of our salvation. Maybe there's someone here, you've never trusted Christ. I need to trust Christ. I want that salvation about which I praise God and thank him for. We encourage everyone to fill out a connection card. You can do that by the offering receptacle out in the entryway here. You can do that through our website, through YouVersion, through our digital bulletin. You can just fill that out. It's how we stay connected with one another. If there's something personal and private, you can check for pastors only and say, I want to get saved, or I have questions about salvation, or maybe you'd like to jot down just a praise for something specific. You know, write down your praise. And we'll praise the Lord together with you. Just jot down maybe how God has spoken to you through our time together here today. Trust you've been encouraged. But if you have any questions or any way in which we can help you, I'll be down front here till after our final song, and then I'll be in the back, and I'd love to talk with you about any questions you may have. I pray that this service, this time of gathering around a psalm in the scripture, will change your heart to be grateful and praise him for all that you have through Jesus Christ. Father, encourage us now with these truths to your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Please stand as we conclude in worship. After pulling through a psalm like that this morning, I believe I should be able to hear the back row singing. Let's sing.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul.
Father, we thank you this morning for your word and for the encouragement that it is to us and for the challenge that it presents to us as we walk with you. I pray that you might put in us a seed of exuberance, of excitement, of joy for what you have done for us. I pray, Father, that we might be able to worship you maybe with a little glimpse of what our sister Millie Alfred is experiencing this morning at your very throne. So I pray that you go before us. I pray that you might encourage us. And Father, that we might, as we live this week, point others through the way we live and the Holy Spirit's work in our life to you, our Savior. And so we give you this week in Jesus' name. Amen.